Dear colleagues, I'm very happy to start this session this morning and to welcome our Professor François Nicolas, who will present his keynote lecture this morning. Professor Nicolas is a composer and theoretician, and his opus is very important and interesting. I hope his lecture will be interesting to all of you. The topic of the lecture is Contemporary Music Does Not Think Alone. Please welcome Professor François Nicolas.
Thank you for your invitation in this very interesting city of Belgrade. My position in your topics, continuity and transition, will be very specific. I will try to present you a way which combines continuation and perhaps something like revolution, you see. Or my question is, is it possible to continue a way by a jump without transition? A friend of mine, the philosopher Alain Badiou, right, the rupture essentially is not interruption but adjunction. So I have modified the title of my paper to better reflect its subject. Here it is: Towards a Terza Pratica, Extending the Music World by the Adjunction of Heterophonies. And subtitle: Contemporary Music Does Not Think Alone. I begin with a citation of Serbian poet Branko Miljković. Barefoot and bitter, you wander from world to world. You will see the importance of the word in my lecture. So you have my paper because an explanation quite difficult perhaps to... Okay, it's more reserved to you to have the paper than I am reading to you now. Music, in particular the music that we call in France contemporary, does not think alone. How can it think with others? I would like to examine this problem with you by posing a more delimited question. How can we conceive today of Terza Platica? As a quick outline of my intention, I would like to first show the musical pertinence and urgency of a terza platica. I will explain, of course, what I mean by that. Secondly, show that such a terza platica could find its musical principle in a heterophonic logic extending ancient polyphonic logic. Thirdly, indicate by which concrete compositional processes we could envisage such a musical extension. Fourthly, determine how to think this terza pratica with other types of thought. On the one hand, with the mathematical thinking of adjunction and of extension, on the other, with a philosophico-political thinking of justice. So, why a terza pratica? I will employ this term in direct reference to what Monteverdi called secunda pratica. The associated musical practice is that which consists in setting words to music. I will distance myself in doing this from the sense that my musicological friend Célestin de Liège gave the term in the 19th of the 20th century. Célestin de Liège was, I believe, a regular visitor of your musicological meetings, and it is for me a joy to recall his memory here. He's dead now. He was inspired then by Hegel, his three stages of the work of art, rather than by the question Monteverdi posed to the vocal musical work. To recall Monteverdi's operation, Monteverdi tried to give music new expressive powers by putting it to the service of the words that it welcomes and it accompanies. It is in serving the words that music masters the new expressivity that authorizes the new tonal system. The previous practice, prima pratica, was founded on modal counterpoint. This counterpoint orders the musical composition of the voices according to a step-by-step construction, point by point, punctus contra punctum. This element by element, note by note, algebraic construction was the law of composition on which the words were arranged, ought to be arranged. At that time, the Middle Ages, music commanded the words and the words served the music. Monteverdi wants to reverse this report. He revives the ancient hierarchy of Gregorian monody, where the Latin prosody commanded the expressivity of the musical neumes. In following this attitude, Monteverdi will reinvent melody in the new harmonic context that authorizes tonality. This melody can no longer arise like the voices of counterpoint from a note-by-note algebraic construction. We know elsewhere the difficulties there will be in conceiving of treaties of melody as though there were treaties of counterpoint, of orchestration, or even of composition. A melody is a musical topology subtly and globally espousing an autonomous prosody. This resurrection of melody, subtly weaving itself around the prosody of a lingual order, comes to modify the musical category of the voice. In the prima pratica, a musical voice had for its partner another musical voice. Such is the principle of counterpoint. Polyphony then resulted from weaving the voices between themselves, stitch by stitch, and constitutes in this way an homogeneous plurality. Certainly, the possible cantus firmus singularly served as a matrix, but it was itself algebraically framed without being melodically ornamented. In this way, the cantus firmus reinforced the skeletal logic of the voice of counterpoint, of polyphonic counterpoint. In total, it fixes the common law for a collectivity of voices than one can declare to be of a fraternal type. This notion of voice, with its principle of modal and contrapuntal polyphony, will be found relativized in the Secunda Pratica. Understand well. Monteverdi does not try to disqualify prima pratica. He does not try to dilate the polyphony of the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. He does not try to reject contrapuntal logic. He tried to extend the notion of the voice by adding a new expectation of expressivity to music. In Secunda Pratica, the voice once more becomes melody, as it was in Gregorian monody, before counterpoint, of course. But this time, it is a new type of melody, because it is a tonal melody. In doing so, the melodic voice will have for partner no longer another voice, as in contrapuntal polyphony, but the functional harmony that the tonal system has just invented. Think, for example, of the compositional practice that Monteverdi will draw from the simple tonic-dominant relationship at the beginning of his madrigal or Quel ciel e la terra. A new system of melody, already harmonized and harmonically accompanied, begins here. And we are familiar with the eminently fecund destiny of it, in the centuries that follow until today. On this point, a new musical power is inaugurated that comes to split the notion of the musical voice into two types: the new melodic type and the old contrapuntal type, which will internally weave functional harmony. One knows the choral destiny of the four voices harmonically superposed. It is worth noting in passing that this process liberates the melodic voices from properly thematic function. Those that appeared in contrapuntal polyphony, starting with Guillaume Dufay, and which agreed with the algebra of notes, pitches, and durations. As such, in this new polyphonic system, the melodic voice is not a thematic voice, as the voice of the cantus firmus could be. The thematic voice is not one of the four voices of harmony, and the four voices, implicit or explicit, of tonal harmony, those that put into movement tonal harmonic functions, are not melodic. We grasp the considerable polyphonic possibilities that the secunda platica offers. Polyphony is organized from then on around a sort of musical division of labor. On the one side, the melodic expressivity that exhausts the sung text and its prosody. On the other side, the dynamic of tonal harmony materialized by a completely new combinatory of voices obeying the old contrapuntal rules. On the last side, some more properly thematic functions brought to bear by such or such local configuration of the system. The polyphony that proceeds from this intrinsic diversity of voices no longer has fraternity as paradigm. On the one side, the melody is a voice that demands its individuality. On the other, the theme affirms a musical consciousness of self. The harmonic plurality, finally, materializes a body in movement. All these turns around a voice that preserves its irreducible specificity by speaking at the same time that it sings. In sum, a sister voice rather than a brother, and a paradigm that recalls love between two sexes rather than the asexual fraternity of counterpoint. We are familiar, of course, with the manner in which this harmonized melody will be able to celebrate the nuptials of love. These new resources, patiently composed around an initial adjunction, the adjunction of a melody in service of a prosody, will give music a new discursive power. It is in fact here that Baroque music, as a musical discourse of an entirely new type, is born. This new discursivity of music will authorize it to enter into closer relationships with the discursivity of the language that it sings. Music will hierarchize and segment its discursive flux according to properly musical and no longer lingual laws. It will, in this way, be endowed with a sort of power of nomination over the words that it sings. Musical discourse phrases its discourse, articulates the phrases produced into different segments, detailing these segments as smaller entities so that it can double the linguistic syntax of the words with an ersatz musical syntax. This doubling will give music the impression that he comments on language. As such, music is endowed with a para-signifying capacity, not a signifying capacity like that of language. Music does not signify, music is not a language, but a capacity to declare that it, music, knows well what language signifies, that it knows well that the words put to music are, for their part, signifiers. Music is endowed in this way with a sort of signifying aura, with a significance that it is not a signification. And it is endowed with it precisely by serving a linguistic signification that remains fundamentally heterogeneous and inaccessible to it. We will formalize this process engaged by the Segunda Pratica by passing over the mathematical models of adjunction and of extension. I will not detail these models here. They are of three types: the cuts of Dedekind, then of Conway, that enable the construction of the real numbers from the rational numbers, then the surreal numbers from the real numbers. The algebraic extension of fields that enables the construction of the field of algebraic numbers from that of the rational numbers, then the field of complex numbers from that of the real numbers. The generic extension by forcing of Paul Cohen. It is worth noting that in the two first cases, the analogy with our three pratique. The cuts, first of all, pass from a numerical prima pratica, that of the rationals, to a secunda pratica, that of the reals, then from the secunda to a terza, that of the surreals. The extensions of fields, first of all, pass from a prima pratica, the field of rational numbers, to a secunda, the field of algebraic numbers, then from the secunda to a terza, the field of the complex numbers. Take from this the following principal idea. One can pass from a secunda pratica to a terza pratica in the same way as one has already passed from a prima pratica to a secunda pratica. For each of these three mathematical models, take my word for it, the process properly called adjunction consists of three successive and cumulative stages. First of all, the construction of words or specific objects composing a lexicon. Then, the transformation of these words into names apt to designate and signify by bestowing the previously constructed words with a properly signifying face. Finally, the construction of statements from these names in order to control from the inside of the original situation the expanded results in the future extended situation. Once this adjunction is effectuated, with words becoming names incorporated into statements, the process of extension consists in making the new adjunct object interact with the original situation. The point is not only to graph, to stick, or to add together, but to engender a recomposition on the entire original situation. The idea is to generate a new extended situation in which the original situation remains a single delimited region, a particular case of what is, from then, ungeneralized. One will say that in this phase of extension, one passes from a simple cut and paste to the production of an ensemble that one transforms a sum into a product, the product of a global interaction. Remember that to add is to construct a system with words becoming names able to produce statements. And remember that to extend is to mobilize these statements to control from the very interior of the original situation, this is the genius of the operation, the global interaction able to generate a situation of a completely different species, an extended situation. We will see how secunda pratica answer to this formal characteristic of an adjunction and an extension before coming to our terza pratica. First of all, the Yerokai segmentation of the tonal phrase forms the fundamental entities which will take the place of words in the new musical discursivity. A musical word is here an elementary melodic harmony motif perceptible and identifiable by ear. Then, these musical words see themselves correlated to ordinary words, those that are pronounced by the text set to music, in order to musically name in quote of course, the words said by the voice. The musical motifs become in this way musical names, able to name the joy or sadness, love or hate, anger or tenderness evoked by the sung text. Think about the leitmotifs of Wagner, but also more generally Baroque rhetoric. Finally, these musical names will interact to compose musical phrases constituting a more global musical discourse, a discourse which will expose and musically express the affects and actions designated by the prosodized language. In this way, musical words, names, and statements come to add to music a new type of melody in comparison to the contrapuntal melody. This melody is endowed with a para-signifying capacity of which I have spoken. The extension to which this adjunction leads holds to the musical generalization of this new expressive capacity, proven a rhyme harmonized melody. Secunda pratica is not only an old instrumental music to which could be added a new type of melodic voice, it is a complete revision that systematically shattered what voice, polyphony, monody, melody, harmony and choir meant until then. In total, the secunda pratica revolutionized the prima pratica, not just by destroying it, not by undermining its foundation to bitter dilate or dissolve it. It revolutionized it from the top down by enlarging the space of thought and relativizing prima pratica, which appears like a particular case, like a circumscribed region of the new extended situation. If you have followed me up until now, I ask you then, can one engage the 31st musical century with the terza pratica, which could be to the secunda pratica what the latter was to prima pratica? Such is the hypothesis at work in my compositional labor, that which guided the choral study entitled Dido and Aeneas, which has its premiere on Wednesday evening. We will examine more closely this hypothesis of a terza pratica. There is, first of all, the idea that we intend to extend the properly artistic power of music by banking anew on a musical delimited pratica, that which sets words to music. As Adorno suggested, music has need of the heterogeneous to remain an art, an autonomous form of thought in order not to fade into the exercise of simple cultural and religious functions. To amuse, to accompany dance, to accompany images, to illustrate themes, to contribute to the sociological identification of the youth, to participate in the sportive cults of a vast stadium, etc., etc., etc. The heterogeneity which I propose to privilege for my music will remain that of language. It will consist then, and this will be my first axiom, in re-examining anew what set words to music can mean today. In terms of words set to music, we shall determine two principal points. These words must say something about this time precisely, in which music wants to be contemporary. The words set to music cannot be just vocalized, mumbling, glossolalia, scat, and other language games. They cannot be limited, moreover, to quotidian babble, to the commerce of opinion. The word set to music ought to signify a contemporary who goes there of sort. Qui vive, enfin, in French. They ought to engage with the emancipatory aspects of this time, against the general dumbing down extolled by globalized capitalism. A lateral thesis could be that globalization is only the supreme financial and imperialist stage of capitalism, and there is nothing insurmountable there. Our first principle will then be, Terza Pratica should carefully choose the words that it wants to set to music. The second principle, the corollary of the preceding one, the setting to music of these words, carefully chosen, should not efface what they say. The words set to music should remain globally comprehensible to the ear. To set to music should not mean to undo linguistic prosody, to take the syntagm apart, to deconstruct the word, to reduce the linguistic discourse to a poor acoustic game of unsignifying phonemes. Our second principle will then be, Terza Pratica should globally respect the phrasing and the prosody of the language mobilized so that the words set to music remain comprehensible. The heterogeneity to which music has recourse should remain heterogeneous and not be musically dissolved, assimilated, or denaturated. When a host invites a stranger, to his home, he does not force him to dress and speak like the natives. There is then the following principal idea. Terza Pratica should enable the extension of different types of musical polyphony to true heterophonies. I repeat, the goal of all this is to extend music. The goal is not to musically welcome the heterogeneous, as though the point was for music to make propaganda for this heterogeneity, by mobilizing the existing repertoire of conventional musical effects. To welcome the heterogeneous, to set a contemporary discourse to music, this should be for music the occasion to invent new properly musical alterities for itself, in order for the global heterophony between the two types of discourse, musical and language, to be a true heterophony, not a simple superposition of a pure collage, it is in fact necessary that this bringing together also mobilizes a heterophony intrinsic to each discourse. As one doubts, this extension of polyphony towards heterophony will correspond to a profound modification of the notion of voice. It will not be completely the same voice that can make music heterophonic, one will not play with alterity as one played with alliance, counterpoint, or melodico harmonic complementation. The voice susceptible to compose a heterophony will not be a voice susceptible to be repeated and varied, as in contrapuntal polyphony. We will say, this will not be the singular of a plural. It will not be, moreover, an indivisible and unrepeatable entity, as it is the melody of secunda pratica. This will not be an individual voice. The voice of heterophony will be itself composite. That is to say, interiorly marked with intrinsic alterity. This is the endogenous condition that allows this voice to participate in a non-accidental manner in a more global heterogeneity. This will be an individual voice, that is to say, interiorly multiple without prerequisite or guaranteed unity. With this condition, heterophony will be something other than the new disparate and arbitrary assemblage of ancient polyphonic voices. Our first compositional principle will then be a heterophony will incorporate intrinsically composite individual musical voice, but this certainly does not prohibit some secondary incorporation of such voices, voice of a more classical type. Our second compositional principle will be, in the setting to music of words remaining words, in the disjunctive duality between music and language, we need a third element. This third element will not come to synthesize disjunction from the top down. It will not, moreover, mediate it from the bottom up. It will rather create the condition of a participation between disjunct orders. Think of the manner in which Plato speaks about a participation between intelligible and sensible. The third element will favor the constitution of a resonance between musical and lingual voices. The third term will be a chorus. As suggests then, the second principle will guide me here, that we need a heterophony of two distinct choruses, susceptible, however, to share the common characteristic of being a choir. We need then an instrumental and a vocal choir. The addition of this term, chorus, involves already a nominal displacement. One passes from the primitive duality of the musical and of the lingual, that of our pratica consisting of setting words to music, to the choral duality of the instrumental and of the vocal. We have in this way begun to make immanent an exogenous contradiction in the music. Certainly, one is not yet finished with the level of lexicon and of names, but we will return to the importance of these instances in the process of adjunction. So then, two choirs. We will have, on the one hand, an instrumental choir. We must then treat the orchestra, or any other more restricted instrumental formation, like a choir, made of composite voices. One sense that this will imply diagonalizing the traditional instrumental families, woodwinds and brins, bowed, plucked or struck strings, skins with or without defined pitches, and so on. One will orient oneself instead towards an extended formula of chamber music, think of Farben, of Schoenberg, where each instrument configures by itself its own little chamber music, interiorizes a specific form of heterogeneity. In such an instrumental choir, with a heterophonic vocation, it will then be difficult to tell exactly the number of voices. On the other hand, that of the vocal, we will have what I propose to call a Babylon choir. That is to say, a choir simultaneously speaking different languages. They will not say the same thing under different simultaneously translation, but synchronically state different ideas. The difficulty will be in ensuring that this heterophony does not degenerate into cacophony, we would say into chaosphony. The stake of the vocal composition will rest on this point. Although we simultaneously set different properties of different languages to music. To do this, the idea will be to play with proto-musical properties of each language. What is the rhythm of its syllable, long, short, accentuated, non-accentuated, agglomerated, or equally distributed? What is the prosody of its accent, syntactic, semantic, word for word, or by syntime, etc., etc. The idea will be that a Babylon chorus, musically pre-structured according to these different types, will be able to more spontaneously interact with an instrumental choir. In my own music, I expect to work with six languages simultaneously: French, Latin, Arabic, German, Russian, and English, regrouped into four categories according to which the prosody is syllabic or not, according to the preeminence or not of a lexical mode of accentuation. You can see the diagram that you have at the end of your paper. I can't explain the diagram, sorry, it's in French, but just to give you an idea of the kind of my work. We are not detailing that here. My Dido and Aeneas began with only three of them, French, Latin, and English. Remark. Does such a Babylon chorus sustain a discourse? No, without doubt. Take the example of spontaneously politically gatherings that constitute themselves as the principal sites of affirmative emancipatory politics. Such were the recent gatherings in Casbah, Tunis, Tahrir, Cairo, Puerta del Sol Squares, Madrid, Sukkoti Park, New York, Taksim Square, Istanbul, until, why not, Maidan Square, Kiev. Each gathering declares without exactly discursing. They declare, for example, down with Ben Ali, down with Mubarak, or we are the 99%, but the sum of all the discourses effectively held on each square at the same instant could not constitute by itself a discourse. In this way, the gathering distinguished itself from the protest, that even spontaneously is unified around some common words that tend to adapt diachronically to a continuous discourse. One will pause then, provisionally, that heterophony declares without exactly forming a discourse. But we will return to our musical focus. In total, the system envisaged will place in global heterophonic resonance, on the one hand, an instrumental choir made of composite voices, on the other, a vocal choir of a Babylon type. I will not detail here a point that merits a more detailed exposé. The most pertinent mode of composition for such a global heterophony arises perhaps from the category of montage or film editing. The stake could then be to constitute a specifically musical version of this category. We could distinguish it from its native cinematographic usage. How to compose a properly musical montage. Such could be a possible horizon for the Terza Pratica that I have in mind. The difficulty is that we are speaking of an horizon, that of an extended musical world. It remains to be seen through which type of adjunction, here and now, it will be possible for us to prefigure it. To return to the proposed formalization, with which new types of properly musical words, names and statements will be able to construct patiently, step by step, the adjunction able to extend our music world. This point opens other compositional problems that concern not so much the intended heterophonic expressivity than the musical system susceptible to produce the new objects that will serve us for words, names, and statements. To recap, Secunda Pratica enlarged Prima Pratica through its new conception of voices, but it was able to do this because it subsumes the old modality in the new tonality, of course. In its turn, a Terza Pratica could enlarge the Secunda Pratica only by associating its new heterophonic orientation with a new type of musical system, extending the whole musical system, modal and tonal, serial and spectral. To detail this new group of compositional tasks could be the sole object of an entirely different lecture. I will content myself to indicate here the manner in which, for my part, I envisage these more technical tasks. It is first of all clear that it could not be done by the simple enlargement of serialism. The serial path was necessary and fecund. It is today saturated, as is the tonal and, a fortiori, modal paths. Spectralism, even more so, could not show the way. For me, I tried to implement a system that articulates the following dimensions. In the first place, it tries to reconfigure a functional harmony around vast structures of pitches that I call rainbow chords. In the second place, I try to globally frame each work around a vast polyrhythmic meter, and it's around this point that the experience of Mallarmé, Stéphane Mallarmé, in his coup de dé, such as been recently laid bare by Quentin Miyasu, interests me. I can't speak of that now, of course. In third place, I start from then to frame the development of the work through a global matrix obtained by blending the rainbow harmonies and rhythmic grids that follow from the two preceding points. Finally, I animate this vast matrix from the inside through a network of gestural figures of local gestalts which come to enlarge the older leitmotivic system. In total, I try then to exceed the triple subtraction at the foundation of the 20th century, no tone, no meter, no theme, without for all that, returning full of remorse, with my head hung low and with a shameful look to the older system of tonality, meter and thematism. What we understand well, and this will be my last point, is that this passage to a Terza Pratica can be today only a fight on two fronts, and no longer on just one as at the time of Secunda Pratica. Against a certain modernism, which advocates being flying before an indefinitely renewed electroacoustic technology, and against a certain traditionalism which advocates a pure and simple return to the naturalist identities of the good old recipes, those of the acoustic tone, of the dancing meter, and of the psychological identifiable theme. So we have, on the one hand, an active nihilism. We want perpetually update technique at the thought of wanting new ideas, and on the other hand, passive nihilism, all desire entails risks So we should content ourselves with managing the long-proven natural. Against these two figures of the same nihilism, the music that wants to continue to be a contemporary form of thought can prolong its old pratica under the form of a terza pratica that seeks the creation of choral heterophony by inserting the musical composition of its new voices with new harmonic, rhythmic, and gestaltic systems. If prima pratica promised contrapuntal fraternity, if secunda pratica magnified the figure of love between dissimilar individualities, terza pratica could contribute to implementing at the heart of the new century and within its unique world a justice here and now. Music could then be the carrier not of hope in the future, not of utopia if you want, but of the hope that justice is already here and that it counts then already universally for all.